to remember the only things that the bobby on the beach used to carry was a truncheon and a whistle.
That's how it was when I joined, it was like that, yeah, so.
Right, come on. Yeah, thanks, Ian. Thanks, Ian, for the report. I think it's fair to say, as councillors, we want to have a good working relationship with the police. And generally, I think that does work great, particularly in areas of our wards where there's, you know, history of antisocial behaviour or crime. You've actually mentioned Birkenhead North, but the ward I represent is Bidston and St James, which covers that. And I do commend you for a lot of the good work that's taken place recently within Bidston and St James. In fact, on Friday this week, you've actually got a police day of action on the Beechwood, which I'm going to. So again, hopefully that will help raise the profile of what you're doing, and it'll give reassurance to people in the community that the police are there. So I do commend you for the work you're doing. But having said that, when you're giving us figures like you've lost 1,500 staff from 211 to 215, it does give me concern. Not just because the figures are going down, because there's a logic behind the figures are going down. It strikes me that the figures are going down because somebody sitting in an office in London is deciding we need to make cuts, we need to save money, and that must make it more difficult for you. And my fear is that going into the future, there might be times when residents in the community are looking for the police to help on issues and there won't be enough of you to help out. So I am concerned about that. But having said that, I do congratulate you on the work you're doing. And it must be very, very difficult when you do see the figures going down. But I am concerned about the future.
I understand that. They're real concerns. You know, as I say, we can't be everywhere all the time. When things come through me and people are raising issues, the community policing teams, more often than not, try and put a bit of a problem-solving package around things to try and get longer-term sustainable solutions. But you know yourself from within the communities, as I mentioned, seasonal issues, operation of banger around, you know, around bonfire nights and mischief nights, you know, historically always causes issues. We try and resource against, you know, what we see as predictive threats. And sometimes we get it right, and sometimes we don't get it right. And when we do get it right, more often than not, and you know, and I take on board the thanks that you provide here. But you know, it's not a good news story that it sells papers. But of course, when we get it wrong, it's in the papers, isn't it? So you know, it's pleasing me with my teams that I am seeing people, particularly police community support officers, who are now embedded in the organisation and are embedded within the communities. And they're taking personal responsibility to lead on a lot of problem-solving activity. I think when those roles first came on board in the organisation, there's probably a little bit of hesitancy, and we weren't really sure, you know, is this an undercover police officer and all that type of thing. But actually, this role is essential to the delivery of community policing for them. You don't necessarily need warranted powers, you just have to speak to people.
Seems to be geared towards auxiliary policemen as such, but they're there to be pulled away from what they're doing to be put on more important cases for the things you can do at your step. I appreciate that, we really do. I think we need more police officers. My concern is that we're going to lose that knowledge from the grassroots area if we keep making these cuts, because they're the guys that get pulled away first off out of that.
Yeah, well, I can respond to a couple of things you have raised there. On the Wirral, we're one of the most proactive areas around human trafficking. I actually met the chair of local Wirral's Optimists the other day, because nationally they have a national drive around human trafficking, anti-slavery, FGM type issues, and they wanted to link in as to how they could support the local work that we do. And we are regularly running operations around particularly some of our restaurants, car washes and the other places that wouldn't surprise you, around people being trafficked, illegal immigrants working with other agencies. And we do get often get the intelligence comms from the community support officers in the first instance. What I would say is I recognise the issues that you're raising, and since no one would expect us to implement a new operating model and it just to go swimmingly smooth. And although, even with the foresight, we thought that might be an issue, and that might be an issue in some of the decisions that were taken, some of the implications, I mean, the major incident is an exception, yeah. Isn't it? But, and we're always going to have to, because actually, we said we would move PCSOs out to the hubs, but when you need just resource, people have asked for Liverpool to come and resource the size of the issues that we've got at the moment. But, our aim is to, as least as possible, get the police community support officers and move them away from their area. Taking on board what you're saying, one of their core roles is around managing scenes, and it always has been built into their job description. It may just be, for whatever reason, time, or whatever, that this happens to be triggering on the same PCSOs that you well know. However, as local police and commanders, we have fed that back as part of the review process of our new model, and we're looking at what opportunities there are to try and resource that in a different way. Probably right of me to talk about the options at the moment, but we're hoping to release some of that capability away from PCSOs and get back to what you're talking about. I mean, I can never get away from the fact, obviously, we've gone from 4 locations to 2 locations. We've given some driving courses to PCSOs so they don't always just have to use public transport to get right the way across the border, because we know some days in particular there's some challenges around moving around on public transport with a more limited service. So I still want them to be the sort of eyes and ears and getting the frontline intelligence for us and feeding that back in. And we've been able to set up some really good examples of cases where it's actually been them that has initiated something that's taken place, and we've also got positive experiences. Station. It comes under a different command structure, but with my rank I still have So if we had a particular issue on us that required additional resource, that could be one of the places I go to ask for additional resource. Of course, because of what's been going on recently, a lot of it's been particularly around north and south Liverpool areas because of the firearms discharges. But we are getting, because obviously keeping, reducing the number of people killed and seriously injured on our roads is one of the issues for us. So we are getting what we call road policing traffic over here, so they're coming over here. If we require dog patrols, they're coming over here. So we are getting elements of it, we just might not get the disruptive elements in the vans. But I have to say, pretty much the same capability with my targeted policing staff now, about 9 vans at Wallasey Police Station. To can put staff into if that's the type of policing we want to achieve. And we might do sometimes if we need to flood a particular area. And we have a variety of different tactics we might use where we pulse a load of resource into an area at one time to disrupt something. And it might be that we actually go to Matrix and ask for those. But go back to what I said earlier on, we have to put that sort of overarching organisational resource to the greatest threats. At the moment, it just happens to be around the north and south Liverpool area. Your final one's about cybercrime.
You should mention cybercrime, I
don't
know.
Well, it really depends, to be honest with you, because you can spend hours talking about cybercrime, because whether it's enabled crime or you've got fraud type activity, which might be online, you've then got obviously the type of activity I described around, it could be hate crime, it could be threats, which they all get up. Certainly the threats type issues get investigated locally. The fraud type issues, generally speaking, go through a national organisation called Action Fraud. They pick out themes, patterns, etc. And they get sent to individual forces to investigate further. And then the more organised criminality, which might be the likes of, attack, but something like a denial of service on a particular website. Organised criminality may go to the likes of either one of our specialist teams, they're based centrally, or dependent on the background to it, it might go to the likes of there's a new agency being set up now, isn't there, on the back of the cyber crime capability and development capability. So
that's nationally held.
There's a nationally held unit, but with any of those types of things, you've got to, it's all about the organisation, it's all about how organised it is, because actually it can be investigated locally, it will be investigated locally.
Given that a lot of crime is information is passed, cyber information, isn't it? Not a lot of people going, hey, what should we be doing tonight? You've got the national agency and you've got each of the regional forces. Does the agency feed into the forces and the forces feed into the agency? Do they all work together? Or do you go there to there but you don't go round to all the others?
And can I ask a question in relation to local policing as well? Because I'm eager not to enter the face of the national introduction.
I just want to know local policing, where I fit in.
Well, for me, any criminality needs to be investigated at the most appropriate level by the most appropriate agency. The greatest proportion of the crime reported within the Wirral area will be getting investigated locally. The type of delivery of the offence, rather than shouting in the street, doing it online, doesn't get away from the fact it's not a complex crime, it's something that can be dealt with locally, so it's dealt with locally. When we get into the more complex situations, we then share information with partner agencies and look towards where is the best place to investigate that, some which may be escalated up to a national organisation, some to a regional capability we've got, or some to our force capability. So without, you could go into the specifics, but I was doing me, but all I'd say is the majority is definitely, the highest volume is definitely locally.
That's what I wondered with the national agency.
Have you learned anything on what we're doing with that?
some of our internal processes, and I think the danger when you set up a functional model, you know, I've had these conversations with some of the people in the room, is there's a danger that you put yourself into a silo. So I'm in charge of local policing, here is investigation, here is our emergency response. You've got to make sure you've got communication across those three areas. So whilst there were benefits in the initial implementation, there were also occasions where we've learned from a communication perspective things that we thought they were doing, they thought we were doing. So we've had to break down those barriers. But no one would expect it to be totally smooth when you start. So what we've done is we've put processes in place to make sure that those issues have been overcome. And for me, it's a continuous improvement. We're on a journey around our savings. It's not going to stop here. It's going to keep on going over the next few years. We're going to keep having to evolve as an organisation, and we're going to have to keep on looking at our housekeeping and all those little things that sit behind us. You know, we get inspected to death by the likes of HMIC and other agencies. You know, it might be around crime reporting. Sometimes you told me it was interesting. You were absolutely right. Crime generally has been falling over the last few years, but the fear of crime is not falling, you know, going down at the same rate. You have issues around pockets of antisocial behaviour, which increase the fear of crime. And then what we might do is we might realise actually, as a result of an audit, we've realised we haven't quite got it right in our way of recording something, and crime suddenly spikes up. The danger is you respond to that spike, but it's a false spike, if that makes sense.
Yeah.
And it's about resourcing things and knowing your business and knowing how you talk and something like that.
You've touched on my next point, and I won't keep us on this for too much longer. But you already seem to be extremely stretched. You've had to change your structure in order to deal with the resources that you currently have. You've mentioned you don't expect this to be the last time you're going to have to deal with cuts to your budget. Have you planned ahead? Are you confident you can still deliver a service on the shrinking budget given the full range of change to your structure? Is the structure being made to allow for further cuts?
The Community First project team was set up back in 2015. There was a lot of separate strands that were going on in different elements of the organisation, and there's a lot of interoperability, so a decision in one has a significant impact in another. And on the back of that, a central one project team was set up, our Community First project team. The three elements that I mentioned there around local policing, response and resolution, investigation, are the first three business cases that are delivering the savings against how they're restructuring. The other elements have yet to deliver the savings necessary out of their business model. But we're also working regionally and nationally with best practice around the country. Our project team are working with other forces to look at, you know, do we need to do something differently around the way we're dealing with domestic abuse, the way we're dealing with crime, the way we're dealing with reporting, that type of thing. So it really is about evolving some of those models. And the likes of what you're probably going to get onto around looking to try and get in a little bit earlier, some of that partnership working will provide other efficiencies as well.
Okay. Chris wants to come back in and support this. I've already been asked on the doorstep what fail safe has been put into place to make sure that all our resources are comparable to a different district, given the operating model seems to allow that improvement. What reassurances can you give to the community that has been put together?
Is that somebody phones the police and they get the police. So that we have a 999 emergency response when it's appropriate. There's a number of processes that have been put in place and uses of technology around mapping that now will recognise where patrols, for example, on the Wirral have been sucked towards some command in Birkenhead or Wallasey, and they no longer have coverage out towards Hassall, the D side of the Wirral, to respond within what we deem to be appropriate time, which is 10 minutes for our emergency response. So there's technology that exists now that's been implemented. There's an individual in our control room. I use the analogy of that maybe old war room pushing things around the table. They're able to do that electronically to move resources. And we can already see from our management information that the way under our old BCU model, we were getting stretched and things, people were getting pulled in. We've changed our shift pattern completely, and it's under constant review because it has a significant impact on the well-being of our staff. But we've changed the model to try and meet demand. So you know, it won't go as a surprise, 8 o'clock on Friday night, Saturday night, it's the highest number of resources on across the force to meet the demand that falls out of nighttime economies and all the other things that take place when people are fed by MMI. So we're constantly reviewing and tweaking to try and get the balance absolutely right. But the management information already demonstrates that we're no longer taking 15 minutes to get to those jobs out in those places because we're pushing the resources around.
Yeah, just a quick question. The ESO down the hall was about the way the policing was going to change and have to change because of the cost of efficiencies and stuff and the lack of funding. One of the things that was discussed was the way that it's about efficiencies and it's the way that the police officers have to jump through so many hoops and have to go through all the stairs and stuff. And the discussion then was that on the lower, sounds terrible, but on the lower end of the scale, that police officers are doing more likely to be able to make their own on-the-spot decisions and seeing that on-the-spot finding and to cut down the fact that they get tired of filling in forms and going back to the station. But how much of that has actually gone ahead now over the last 2 years? Just had a personal question.
Well, funnily enough, the people who were at the presentation in January, one of the elements was around giving personal responsibility around discretion within the organisation. This is what the Chief Constable is driving at the moment. I think because of the culture that we went through sort of in the early 2000s, very, very performance orientated, always kicked decision making out to first and second line managers. And so it's been a bit of a, not just us, nationally, the police service. And so we now recognise what we're talking around early help, getting in, you know, what's in the best interest? Do you want to criminalise that young person? You know, is that in the best interest of them and the victim? That actually we're trying to empower staff to, we're not talking about cutting corners by any stretch, we're talking about doing the right thing. You know, and we're doing about dealing with things at an appropriate level. There's still all going to be safeguarding issues, referral issues, that type of thing. But it is very much the drive in what's going on around our efficiencies at the moment.
Okay, thank you very much, Superintendent. That's extremely helpful. With that done, then we'll move on to agenda item 5. That's okay. And 4, sorry, I'm going to invite Mark Tom to this presentation.
Chair, thanks very much. I don't need to introduce myself, but I will introduce the two colleagues at the end of the table because we're going to, this presentation, you'll be happy to know you're not just going to listen to me. I brought Tracey Hayes and Ben Ryder and asked them to come because Tracey has been, and is seconded over to us in terms of the integration project we're going to talk about and some of the blend. And I thought it'd be better, because you've heard me talk about it before, that you can ask Tracey some challenging questions like you normally ask me. And Ben, again, working in that partnership, really emphasising what Ian was talking about, the new ways of working. Yes, we've always worked in partnership. We've always said we'll come to meetings and work together. But actually, this is about now really, really examining ourselves and saying, who is the best agency to lead something? Who's the best to deliver that piece of work? And who's the best person to provide that service for the outcomes that the citizens and the community of Wirral deserve, I would suggest. So I'm going to do a first couple of slides which talk about the pledge. Is that feedback really bad?
Yeah, they're going to all get it now.
Do I need it?
No,
you can
just keep going.
Right, okay. So, a recap in terms of where we are with the pledge. So you'll all be aware that we did the Wirral as a whole public sector partnership group came up with 20
ensuring our neighbourhoods are safe. And that was to set the direction for community safety in Wirral over the next 5 years. And it has four delivery outcomes, if you like, at the end of those 5 years. That we would have safer communities with lower levels of crime and antisocial behaviour. We'd have shared communities where each person's rights are respected. And we'd have confident communities where people feel safe and have confidence in the agencies that serve them. And I think that's really important, because if we go back a couple of years to when this pledge was agreed, we just undertook the Wirral survey, and the highest, if you like, indicator that came back from that was that 60% of our local populace across the patch were feeling unsafe. So that might not have been a reflection on crime rates, because we told that they'd be coming down year on year, but actually, the people who were living out there on the patch felt unsafe, and we needed to understand why that was. So this pledge was very much driven about what we can do, how we can drill down further, and what we can do to try and change those perceptions. And everyone will know, when you're dealing with people's perceptions and cultures, it's not a click of the fingers and an overnight result. It's something you need to work on and build on working with those communities. So our priorities are the pledge. The pledge itself was built on and designed and written with the cooperation and the input from all of the partners that come together in our community safety partnership. And that's over sort of 15 organisations and members from Neighbourhood Watch and community groups and things of that nature. So when we came up with the pledge initially, it wasn't just the suits or people like me stood at the front saying, well, we think this is a fantastic idea, and away we go. We had their endorsement in it. So our priorities were about building stronger and more confident communities where people feel safe. How are we going to do that? We're really trying to pick up on some of the things that Ian was mentioning. We knew coming down the line for all of the public services that there was going to be resource reduction due to budgets, etc., etc. And because of that, what we and these are things that many councillors have emailed me about, we are collectively trying to pool our resources around this theme, so that actually the greater good can come with the community resource that we can all apply together, rather than us all trying to do our own individual elements or something. Improve community safety by tackling the cause and impact of crime and antisocial behaviour. So a good example of this would be that our antisocial behaviour team used to sit in Cllr campus, and we'd have officers that would drive to meetings with Ben's guys on one day and Tracey's guys on another day, and then they'd come back and speak to me, and everybody going backwards and forwards. Well, do you know what? Isn't it just better to put them in the room and let them work together and actually decide what those priorities are from the information intelligence coming forward, and agree amongst that multi-agency set on a day-to-day basis who is the most appropriate agency to tackle that issue at that moment in time? Because sometimes it isn't the best person to send a uniformed or a PCSO or police constable to go and knock on someone's door, because we know the intelligent might be that that individual might immediately go, I'm not talking to them. Yeah? We know Ben's guys and female firefighters, they only have to turn up in their red appliance, the doors are flying open because everybody wants to talk to a firefighter. So there's different people involved in delivering different things. When we've got people talking about human trafficking and things of that nature, Councillor Carubia mentioned the point about PCSOs, and I think somebody else said it about what an important asset they are out on the ground about that intelligence gathering. Well, we have officers out on the ground covering a range of services as well, and just informing them and getting them involved in the process around passing on that information and being part of those processes allow us then to capture as much information as we can to target that resource. We protect the most vulnerable in our community, and I don't think that would cause too many consternations amongst people. The question is, what does vulnerability mean? I can assure you that people on Saturday night around New Ferry at 9 o'clock didn't feel vulnerable. I bet you they did at 17 minutes past 9 at night. So it's a thing that we need to look at all the time dynamically. So we know there's vulnerabilities around domestic abuse. Why do we know that? Because the statistics are out there, and the information intelligence is out there that tell us that. So in terms of our approach to this, we're talking about community safety and Pledge 19 here tonight. but we have pledged 7-0 tolerance to domestic abuse as well. And in terms of some of the things we talk about with the safe and little hub that we're going to talk about as we move forward, it's those type of vulnerabilities that, again, that shared intelligence, targeted work with our safeguarding teams, with the vulnerable persons, detectives from the police, from the fire visits and home visits that the other agencies do undertake, we can make sure that we're giving confidence to those people who are suffering abuse of whatever nature to come forward, and we can spot those signs and try and target our resources to go and assist those people. And then obviously delivering greater integration. We're going to talk quite a bit about that tonight, because that's where really we think the wins will come for everybody out there. So, future plan, we started off the first year of the pledge was in your pack, and a number of those outcomes you will see were very ambitious. Target dates were set against them, which were incredibly ambitious at the time. Hand on heart, when we were having those discussions, I remember thinking, really, will we do that by March 2017? Well, in some cases we haven't, and I think people have got the right for me to sit up here and say, what's that up here, and say that we have delivered everything, because we haven't. What we do need to do in the new action plan, there's a refresh going on in the action plans this year, coming out for this year. We're very much making them more smart, so that you as elected members, when we come to scrutiny, you can then sit with us and say, and challenge the officers at the front to say, why wasn't this done by then? Because the smart target was set, which was realistic and time-bound. I accept that first version of that pledge went out from there, some of those targets just were not realistic and certainly weren't smart actions. However, that hasn't stopped us from some of the successes and some of the things we've done, we'll go on to say. We're going to continue to work with our communities and third sector organisations to address the sector of crime, so we need to get communities more involved. Again, Ian spoke about some of those successes, about residents and neighbourhood groups ringing in now and writing in to say how fantastic it is that we work together, we come together to start tackling some of those problematic incidents and things that go on. Invariably, that intelligence of what the causation is, it's normally down to one or two families or individuals in those areas. When we gather that and the police gather that information in our SPT, we can target our resources to against those families that cause those issues. We're seeking greater integration with the third sector, so some really, really exciting, I think, exciting new programs of work we work with. So we've just been on you from Involved Northwest. Many of you will know about the community connectors that are starting to come online. So again, another resource for people who are out there, primarily looking at health outcomes and determinations, really. But actually, where's the best place for them in that intelligence gathering to feed that back into the hub about things that might be going on, with vulnerabilities especially? And when we talk about vulnerabilities, I think one of the great outcomes of this piece of work will be that ability to track the demand management across all those agencies, because some of those more isolated and neglected members in our communities, some of those can become incredibly high demand generators in terms of numbers of calls that they put in continuously. Well, those community connectors, we see it as a fantastic opportunity to link those people up, to undertake signposting with them, and to provide them some assurance and some pathways that will maybe reduce the demand management on the statutory intervention and statutory service side. That's the challenge as we go forward. And then the last thing on the future bit is about the governance of it. We're going to launch a new Safer Whittle Partnership Board, a new CSP, responsible for the pledges, Pledge 7 and Pledge 19. So they, as a community partnership, and the members of that community partnership, will own the outcomes of this. And actually, as a partnership, they'll be, if you like, governed and processed through that partnership board process, similar to the outcomes of lots of other partnership boards, such as health and wellbeing and things of that nature. One action for the pledge, and I'm going to get on to the others. Apologies if I'm going fast, but I'm just conscious I want to get on to allowing to ask as many questions. But one action for the pledge was about seeking greater integration. And I know know this isn't very clear on the slide, but we'll send this out to everybody with the papers. And again, if you've got questions afterwards, you can come and let me know. But what this was trying to demonstrate is really a sort of logic diagram of the direction of travel around this concept of a safer Wirral Board. So the top layer, if you like, is we've got a safer Wirral Partnership Board, the new CSP. Isn't it strange that the CSP, the Community Safety Partnership, statutorily required until 12 months ago it had no representatives from the safeguarding boards of? Well, you'd think that was absolutely madness nowadays, given what we've talked about with CSE, safeguarding issues and vulnerability. So we're bringing the safeguarding representatives onto the partnership board again so that those worlds can be linked up as we move forward. The hub itself, if you like, in the middle section, is the idea of this is that it is predominantly a co-located management team that will deal with the demand management and the tasking out to the areas of all the jobs around community safety and the intelligence that comes in that hasn't been dealt with at the highest level by the MASH, the strategic call. So it's an integrated front door, the referrals will come in through there. Once they go through the triage at the multi-agency strategic call end, through that top end of statutory regulation requirement, if they don't meet those thresholds at level 4, they will come into the Safer Wirral Hub, and the Safer Wirral Hub will manage those to make sure that they go to the appropriate agency to get an outcome that comes back. And again, we think that's something that when the concept of a multi-agency safeguarding hub was first muted, it was very much that model that was trying to be achieved, but it became purely safeguarding rather than wider strategic. And we think, again, from the feedback from elected members, communities, and we think that we believe in those conversations that the most appropriate agency to lead that multi-agency team is the police. So we went and made a case to the Chief Constable through all that model and the reduction of senior management that you've heard Ian talk about. We managed to convince him to do two things. One, he signed a memorandum of understanding with our chief executive and said, we really support this and we think it's a fantastic way forward to explore whether it works. And two, we'll give you Tracey as a superintendent out of the police structure, if you like, to be able to do that work and to prove that concept. And by September this year, we'll have that we're programmed to have a final business case for phase one, if you like, of all this piece of work that says these things work, these things may work, we haven't had time to look at them, but we may look at them as in the future, but really let's move forward with these things that do work. And then obviously the delivery at the bottom is all of, if you like, the district delivery units, wherever they may be. So if it was a young person-centric issue that we're looking at, it might be that goes to early help out of one of the children's centres or something like that. So the idea of these is being processed map as we speak. We've got these people together and we're working through the detail of those processes and those pathways. So I know I've done a bit of a whistle-stop tour just on the introduction to the hub. I think what I would like to do I'll stop there and invite Tracey to come up and talk a little bit more about the successes and what's gone on actually in the hub, and then Ben's going to do a little bit about the fire service bringing that, and I'll wrap it back up with one slide at the end. That's okay. Tracey.
Part of phase one was to integrate the anti-social behaviour team into
community